Y'all, we are going to get underway this morning. Rebecca is going to roll our first video segment as we gather here at this river virtually. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our Love Stream service of the River of Grass Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Davie, Florida. I'm the Reverend Amy Carol Webb, and my pronouns are she, her, and they. Like so many across this world, we are under shelter-in-place orders, and so we meet here where the medium is virtual, but the bonds of community we share are some of the realest we have ever known. And so valuable to us in this time of great uncertainty. It is good to have you with us this morning. In this congregation, it is our mission to nurture our spirits, love intentionally, and create a just and healthy planet. This is part of our enduring search for truth, meaning, and faith. What we share here is not an unchanging dogma, but an affirmation that we are called to be agents of love and justice and to build a world where everyone is cherished for who they are. Our mission is not changed. In this time, the world seems to have tilted on its axis. In fact, it seems all the more a brilliant flame to light our way. Our connections are not weakened by the physical distance we must keep at this time, but strengthened in the growing awareness of our gratitude for the bonds we share with one another, our vision and the mission that we travel together. We are all in an interconnected web of all being and with the holy by any name, which we feel all the more acutely on this 50th anniversary of Earth Day. However you have made your way among us this morning, we welcome you exactly as you are from exactly where you are. And we just promise that we won't leave you there. We don't promise to have better answers, but we are together seeking better questions. So as we gather in this space, let us take a few breaths to gather ourselves together in this world that is moving both way too fast and not fast enough. And one more. Now let us gather within these words given by the beloved naturalist and poet Wendell Berry in his piece entitled, All Too Aptly for Us Now, The Wisdom to Survive. If we will have the wisdom to survive, to stand like slow-growing trees on a ruined place, renewing it, enriching it, if we will make our seasons welcome here, asking not too much of earth or heaven, then a long time after we are dead, the lives our lives prepare will live here. Their houses strongly placed upon the valley sides, fields and gardens rich in the windows, the river will run clear, and we will never know it. And over it, birdsong, like a canopy. On the levels of the hills will be green meadows and stock bells in noon shade. On the steeps where greed and ignorance cut down the old forest, a new forest will stand, a rich leaf drifting on its roots. The veins of forgotten springs will have opened. Families will be singing in the fields. In their voices, they will hear a music risen out of the ground. They will take nothing from that ground that they will not return, whatever the grief at the parting. Memory, native to this valley, will spread over it like a grove, and memory will grow into legend, legend into song, and song into sacrament. The abundance of this place, the songs of its people and its birds will be health and wisdom and indwelling light. This is no paradisal dream. Its hardship is its possibility.
Circle round for freedom. Circle round for peace, for all of us imprisoned. Circle for release. Circle for the planet. Circle for each soul. For the children of our children, keep the circle whole. Circle round for freedom, circle round for peace. land. Circle for release. Circle for the planet. Circle for each soul. For the children of our children. Keep the circle whole. Circle round for freedom. Circle round for peace. For all of us imprisoned. Circle for release. Circle for the planet. Circle for each soul. For the children of our children. Keep the circle whole.
The flaming chalice is a symbol of our Unitarian Universalist tradition, a beacon of religious liberty shining through generations, now ours to hold high. Please join your voices for this morning's chalice lighting. We light this chalice for all our earthly kin, for those of feather, fur, and fin. For those with legs, two, four, and more, those high in the sky and on the ocean floor, for those that fly and those that creep, those that sing in the day and awake while we sleep. For all creation, our family, we kindle this fire, to know all of them and each of us have a place in Earth's choir.
In the light of love, let us renew our covenant as we say together.
Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
El amor es el espíritu de esta congregación. El servicio es su ley principal. Esta es nuestra gran promesa. Vivir juntos en paz, buscar la verdad a través del amor, ayudarnos mutuamente.
This morning of the 50th Earth Day, we honor our long Unitarian Universalist history of loving and tending Mother Earth with a spotlight on our UUMFE, the Unitarian Universalist Ministry for Earth. After centuries of trusting the truths of science, conservation, and ecology, 31 years ago, our Unitarian Universalist General Assembly called UUs to an environmental justice movement drawn from ecology theology, which led planetary prophets the Reverend Bob Murphy, Rachel Stark, and Brian and Roxanne Reddington Wild to establish our Green Sanctuary program. It blends religious traditions, religious education, church administration, and community action into one program. Since then, the Unitarian Universalist Association, its affiliate, action and education programs, and its member congregations have partnered for fossil fuel divestment, climate justice trainings and action, ethical eating programs, and the UU Climate Action Network, and many other global and local initiatives, while UUs across North America and the world help organize through Green Faith, 350.org, Greenpeace, and many interfaith power and light chapters the world over. This is a great day for you and your family to get involved at their website, www.uumfe.org. This is our heritage and our hope. In our community each week, we share pieces of our lives. This too takes a new form for our new normal. First, we'd like to just hold a moment in this fast-changing world to feel our feelings. In this time, we must pause. And at the same time, also keep going, because life does keep going and the earth is forever turning. We keep on hoping, and we keep on loving, and we keep on reaching, and we still keep looking for those rich resources that nourish ourselves in body and in soul, and that nourish our community. So take a moment here to just feel that, feel it all, knowing that you are among people with whom you are safe to have your feelings, whatever they may be. When we are in our building, we share via writing in a book and lighting candles. Here, we share in the chat space. So if there is something that you would like for us to bring forward into this group to hold in our hearts, you can put it there. Shawnee says hi. Oh, Lou. Lou says, my sister died yesterday. She was 71. Wish you all could feel my joy when I remember our adventures together when we were children. We're thinking about you, Lou. Happy anniversary to Janet and Roy Schwartz. Happy anniversary, you turtle doves, you. We'll hold for a minute here while others can share if they like to. There's no right or wrong feeling for this time. There's no right or wrong. There's just what we are, who we are, and what we feel. Nicole says, gratitude for the One World Together at Home concert yesterday, the opportunity for connection and solidarity through music and global community put out by global citizens was just what I needed. It was a great program. Mary says, I'm so glad I finally found the service. I'm a UU. Without a church, when you said you are safe, it made me weep. We cherish your tears. We're so glad. We're so glad you're here. Susan has lit a candle for Bruce. Ellie says, welcome to my sister Grace Fruit Mousy joining us from Park City, Utah. Wow. Aisa says, congratulations to Pablo, who just graduated from FIU. This thing is going fast. Oh, with a teaching degree in biology. Oh, well, we need you, Pablo. We need you right now. Jeannie Mastin. Lisa is noting that Jeannie Mastin's fur baby Daisy is having surgery. We will be holding Daisy in our thoughts for her surgery to go well. Happy birthday to Patrick Sanders and Bill Gupton. Oh, yes. And that Patrick got back safely from the eastern shores in the midst of all of this. Esther and Margie, we light a candle for our 87-year-old friend who died last week after a long struggle with Alzheimer's. Herta Whitman introduced Margie to Unitarian Universalism. We owe Herta a great, great debt of gratitude. Thank you. Judy says she's grateful for video chats with her children and their families. Ah, me too. I'm so sad for Bruce's passing. Let's clarify here. It was Bruce's, I just lost Bruce's last name. Bruce and Susan. Zena, would you type that in really quickly? I'm so sorry. My brain just blanked out on me.
Seidenstein.
Seidelstein, yes?
Seidenstein.
Yeah, Seidenstein. We're keeping Bruce and Susan and their family in our hearts today. Mallory says, grateful for my vision and insight, which carries me through it all with innate knowledge that there is so much more than what I experience here on this plane of existence. Absolutely. Kathy Jens Rockow, I would like to share my pride and love for my two children. Rob stepped up to help Steve's cousin in her promotion, and Julie, whose entire family stepped in and volunteered in the tornado cleanup in North Georgia. Absolutely. Someone's iPhone said to everyone, grateful for the healthcare workers, first responders, food deliverers, restaurant workers, grocery store personnel, etc., who put themselves in harm's way. I think all of our iPhones will say amen to that in this moment. From Shawnee, Mary Lisa says, from Shawnee, I'm happy to have a community of people I can rely on. Yes, we're discovering that in new ways that we never thought about. You need my microphone volume up? Okay, hold on a second here. We'll take care of that right now. Is that a little bit better?
Better?
Okay. Grace says she's grateful to be invited by her sister Ellie from Utah. We're glad you're here. Thanks to Scott and Carolyn for the beer tasting party yesterday. Now, I know they found a very, before y'all get excited, they found a very interesting way to do their beer tasting workshop with River of Grass and still keep social distance. So I know they did it. So we are finding all kinds of new ways to make the connections that are so precious to us. Beisa is lighting a candle for all the individuals who passed from coronavirus, to all of our first responders, nurses, doctors, chaplains, farmers, grocery store, and everyone who is holding our society together. Yes, we have an opportunity for our society to see that the essential workers are the very same ones that too many do not want to pay a living wage. And it's going to be up to us to make that change happen as we make our return when this pause is over. Jeannie says, to my friend Kathy, who's undergoing a difficult part of her cancer treatment, we will hold her in our thoughts. Oh, iPhone is Besa. Okay. And Maureen lends an amen. Natalie says to everybody, we rock. June says, my nephew is asking his love to marry him within the next 4 hours. This is great joy. Love carries on, even in the midst of pandemic, y'all. And let's see. All right. And Denise says, remembering my toddlers with fur today, Raven, Casper, Salem, and Galileo. Let us take a moment to take in all of these things, to lift them up. William James wrote that we are like islands in the sea, separate on the surface, but connected in the deep. And now we're keeping physical distance, but reaching ever stronger in our spiritual connections. We remember the suffering around us and among us, also knowing none of us can be ever truly separate. Let us keep a moment of silent reflection and then lift these things in the spirit of prayer. Source of all, called by many names, none of which we can fully know. We lift all these things, written and unwritten, spoken and unspoken, trusting that our hearts will be seen and asking that we become better seers of hearts. So many in our world share this moment of yearning for connection, of appreciating with gratitude and with prayers of protection those that are on the front lines, those that are keeping our society rolling, while others have the privilege of remaining at home, and yet others are at home but not privileged to work from there, and now wondering what their life will be, what their work will be, how they will support themselves and their families in this new turning that we are experiencing now. We ask that we not try to get comfortable, that we allow the discomfort that we feel right now to inform our mission and our ministry, to awaken our vision to the realities of what our society is and is not, and the ways that it has not ever functioned well for some, for too many, and how we will now have a choice on how it gets put back together to support these people, whom we have too long taken for granted, whom we have too long not fully seen in our headlong rush to live our lives, in this time of stopping, of slowing, of listening, of seeing. May we dare to not only transform this world as we talk about for the ages, but to be transformed so that this transformation can happen. And not leave it to any government or municipality, but take it upon ourselves to make it so. Amen and amen, amen. Aho, ashe, namaste. Blessed be. And so it is. We need our youngins to come to the screen because we're going to have our wisdom tale now. Miss Karen, we're ready for you.
Sidewalk cracks, the garden. Parents, please bring your children to their screen so they can take part in our wisdom tale this morning. Today's tale is titled The Curious Garden by Peter Brown and adapted by me. There once was a city without gardens or trees or greenery of any kind. Instead, it was full of factories, apartment homes, and other big buildings. Since its railway system stopped working years ago, this city was also full of cars and buses. Most people spent their time indoors, as the sky was not very healthy. As you can imagine, it was a very dreary place. However, there was one boy who loved being outside, even though the sky was really gray. He'd always known it to be that color. Even on drizzly days, while everyone else stayed inside, you could always find Liam happily splashing through his neighborhood. It was on one such morning that Liam made several surprising discoveries. He was wandering around the old railway, as he did from time to time, when he stumbled upon a dark stairwell leading up to the tracks. And since Liam had always wanted to explore the tracks, there was only one thing for the curious boy to do. Liam ran up the stairs, pushed open the door, and stepped out onto the railway. The first thing he saw was a lonely patch of color. Wildflowers and plants were the last things he'd expected to find up there. But when he took a closer look, it became clear that the plants were dying. They needed a gardener. Liam may not have been a gardener, but he knew he could help. So he returned to the railway the very next day and got to work, watering, weeding, and pruning. Now most gardens stay in one place, but this was no ordinary garden. With miles of open railway ahead of it, the garden was growing restless. It wanted to explore, just like Liam. The tough little weeds and mosses were the first to move. They reached their tendrils and sent their seeds and spores flying. Soon they popped up further and further down the tracks and were closely followed by the more delicate plants. Over the next few months, Liam and the curious garden explored every corner of the railway. Grasses rambled around the rocks. Blossoms bloomed between the tracks. Butterflies and bees found their way to the blossoms, and birds nestled in the growing brambles. Soon Liam noticed something else, the sky. Liam noticed a hint of a blue sky peeking through the dark clouds. Liam was curious. Was his growing garden cleaning up the sky? Soon, the garden became even more curious, too, and wanted to explore the rest of the city. Once again, the tough little weeds and mosses set out first. They popped up further and further from the railway and were closely followed by the more delicate plants. Vines clung to the sides of buildings, trees rooted between sidewalk cracks. The garden was especially curious about old forgotten things. An old car became the perfect garden plot. Liam started noticing new visitors to his garden. Squirrels scurried up and down the trees. Lizards found sunny resting spots on the rocks. Even a fox could be found, hiding behind the mulberry bush when the sun began to rest his head. But the most surprising things that popped up were the new gardeners. It seemed other city folk were curious about this ever-growing garden too, and began to wander through this new naturescape. I bet they noticed the bright blue sky that now smiled down upon them. Within a few years, the entire city had blossomed. By then, most of these new gardeners, who used to stay indoors all the time, now knew each other by name, transforming this little city into a community of caretakers who gave just enough to return their little city into the natural habitat it was always meant to be. Now, I understand that during this stay-at-home time, we too have some nature finding its way back to our communities. Sea turtles in South America are easily finding their nesting spots and returning to the sea without worry of being trapped by beach chairs because they're on closed beaches. Goats are finding the empty streets of a Welsh town, perfect place to wander without cars or people. Even humpback whales are enjoying being able to navigate shipping lanes without ships. And in Los Angeles today, the air is cleaner than it's been in years, much like Liam's little town. Residents are noticing fish returning to the canals of Venice, Italy, where the streets are waterways, now filled with fish, enjoying a good swim without all the gondolas racing through. I wonder if during this stay-at-home time, we could wander outside and notice, are any plants moving? Are plants popping up in new places? Is the sky bluer? Who else shares our yard with us? And when we're able to really leave our homes again, will we continue to appreciate the other life that shares this planet with us? Will we become better stewards of our Earth? I'm curious.
I'm curious too. Lately, I've been reliving an experience of my youth. It was an early spring day, and I was out in the countryside of eastern Oklahoma about 20 miles away from Muskogee. I was riding horseback like the wind and pushing this blue mare that was entrusted to me to enjoy that spring day just as much as I was. Now, she'd given me several clear signals that she was done. She'd had enough, and she was ready to head back for the barn. But I ignored her because I wanted a little bit more of that sunshine and that feeling of the wind in my hair and the joy that I got from riding out across that open pasture land on that mare. And then suddenly, she planted her front hooves, came to a dead stop, and threw me off over her head into the high grass. And while I lay there, gasping for breath with the wind knocked out of me, wondering what had just happened, she turned and headed back across the pasture, free of me, and leaving me to walk back on my own once I could stand up again. I was so mad. I didn't know until I made it back to the barn that she hadn't really thrown me. No. You see, I'd pushed her even after she signaled me that she needed to stop. I pushed her till she pulled up lame. And it was her stumbling in pain that threw me off. The stable master was understandably furious, and for the rest of that entire spring, I was forbidden to ride. Instead, I was assigned to slop the stalls for all the horses and tend to that mare's healing every day. And then a while later, after her foal was born late in the spring, it was my job to care for her foal until both the foal and the mare were well and strong again. Now, this story from my youth came to mind for me in the past few weeks as I thought about how life as we have known it has come to just such a sudden halt. We're wondering if our Mother Earth is offering, or I'm wondering, if she's offering a similar wisdom to that I learned that spring so long ago. Thinking about how selfishly we humans have pushed our planet to carry us, to move faster and faster to accommodate us, even as she keeps giving us sign after sign after sign that we need to slow down, that we need to change course, that for some things we need to stop altogether. Until, like I found myself on that spring day out in Oklahoma, on the ground gasping for breath. Now we have been thrown off our headlong destruction of life itself, and we're still stunned and wondering what is happening, and even how we'll ever ride again. But while we are hurting inside our homes, wait a minute, not everybody is inside. Not everybody is at home. You who are essential workers, we understand you are essential, better now than ever. For our first responders, our nurses and our doctors, those who deliver the mail, those who bring our packages, those who keep our society rolling, we thank you and we hope you know we keep you in our hearts through this time. And you who are working because you're being forced to work, to keep your jobs, and to work unsafely on top of that, we pray not only for your protection and for your health, but also that justice may come and realize our responsibility in helping that day to come. But while so much of the world has come to a stop because we are stopped, as Ms. Karen said just a few minutes ago, some remarkable things are happening outside our doors. The air all over the world is clearing. So much so we can see the difference in photos from space. Water is clearing up. Animals are moving about more freely. Some people have even suggested that there are more animals, but we're not sure about that. It's more likely that they've been there around us all along. We just slowed down enough to notice. And so on this 50th Earth Day Sunday. We come to bless the animals in our lives and on our planet. First, we'll take a moment to remember the animals that are no longer with us, the companions we have loved, who've traveled with us in the past and now travel with us in our hearts. We hold them now in thankful memory. Please take a moment to breathe and remember them and thank them. And let us also bless those beloved creatures who cannot be with us, even though they are still among us on this planet, who can't be with us right at this time. We hold them in our hearts, wherever they may be this morning. For our blessing this morning, we heed the wisdom of the Suquamish and Duwamish Elder Chief Seattle, who said this: "What is humankind without the animals? If all the beasts were gone, we would die from a great loneliness of spirit. For whatever happens to the beasts soon happens to us. The earth does not belong to us. We belong to the earth. We are connected like the blood which unites one family. We do not weave this web of life. We are merely strands in it. Whatever we do to this web, we do to ourselves. Help us to look with understanding upon all the creatures of this world, to see them as our relatives upon this earth. For the times we have been careless and have forgotten to treat the earth and her creatures with respect, we ask forgiveness. And when we look into the eyes of those creatures entrusted to our care, may we know that the spirit of life itself looks back at us through them. So may it be." And now for our family companions. If you have yours with you, hold them close. You might even lift them up so that we can see their faces in this screen along with yours. Keep them close as we bless them and thank them for going with us through this time, through every time, and for being there for us at all times, even when we don't always notice them. We thank them for teaching us to sing in the morning and howl at night, to purr without ceasing and wag our tails with delight. For those that crawl here below or fly up above, to teach us the meaning of joy and of love. As we heal this great web of which we are all a part, may they know our love. May we be worthy of theirs from their purest and bravest of hearts. May it be so. Now, back in the spring of my childhood, when I selfishly hurt that mare, it was my job afterward to clean up the mess I'd made, to help her back to health, and then when she had her foal, to tend that new life too, till they were both well and strong enough to go out into the pasture land and play in the morning sun. In this great pause that we are living through, what may we learn about our relationship with the earth and about what our part is to make it well and strong again so that we can all play in the morning sun? Oh, and one more thing. As always happens with disasters, we're seeing a bunch of unfortunate theology going around out there now, social media, other places. It's one way our limited human minds try to make sense of things that we don't fully understand. So there's some around us who are suggesting that this, no, some are insisting, not just suggesting, that this pandemic is a punishment of some kind, from God or even from nature herself, While a tendency toward this way of thinking is nothing new, it's also nothing true. And it's certainly not in alignment with our Unitarian Universalist understanding of life at all. We don't hold for a theology of retribution and punishment. But we do understand there are consequences for our actions and lack of actions. Consequences that are sometimes favorable and sometimes not. What if all of life is just one vast algorithm of consequences of the choices we make and the ones we don't, of the ways we live and the ways we don't? You remember in my story how I was so angry because I thought that mare had thrown me? Until I learned what really had happened is that my riding her too hard had caused her to pull up in pain, which caused her to stop suddenly, and that's what threw me off. She was not punishing me. She was hurt by my actions and stopped in pain, and so my landing hard on the ground was simply the natural consequence of my own actions. Well, for some time now, we've been seeing the natural consequences of our exploitations and abuses of our planet. Just last year, the United Nations reported that nature is declining globally at an unprecedented rate, and that, I want to get this right, and that the health of the ecosystems on which we and other species depend is deteriorating more rapidly than ever. And then the report goes on to say we are eroding the very foundations of our economies, livelihoods, food security, health, and quality of life worldwide. But that report also went on to say that it is not too late to make a difference, but only if we change our ways globally and locally now. And then the report calls for the transformative changes needed to restore and protect nature. So what if this thing that we are in right now, what if this great pause, for all its pain, for all its struggle, we do not minimize those, we see those, and we are hurt by those every minute of every day. But what if one of the consequences of this great pause is an opportunity for the kinds of transformative changes we've been asked to do for generations, and that our earth might not suffer so under our weight? What if this is a chance to see the consequences of our actions and lack of actions and change our course? While we've brought life as we know it to a sudden halt, and I did say we. While we've brought life as we know it to a sudden halt in the attempt to save our own lives and everyone else's, what if we're actually saving Earth's life too? And now, here come some of our River of Grass animal friends to show their faces too. Thank you. beloved community and its mission in our world through the gifts of our time and skills, our love and laughter, and our money. Each Sunday, half of our undesignated offerings go to LifeNet for Families, which provides hot meals 365 days a year, as well as clothing and support here in Broward County. The other half supports the mission and ministry of River of Grass. This sharing practice is more crucial than ever in this tumultuous time, where we commit again to do our part to support the people most at risk in our community. So, since we can't pass our baskets as usual right now, how do we do that? We have centralized several ways to give on our River of Grass website at the link you see on the screen and in the chat. If you like using text to give, you can still do that. If you're accustomed to putting a regular amount in the basket, you can now do that digitally on our donate webpage, either by using the donate button or contacting our office to set up an automatic donation so you don't have to think about it until we gather again. You can take a moment to do that now as the music plays, or do it later, or if you need support to set that up, please contact our office and we'll help. Whatever method works best for you, please give generously and joyfully, that we may feed and fortify this congregation and its good work in the world that needs it now more than ever.
Thank you. We extinguish this chalice flame, but not the fire that burns within, nor the light that leads us on.
In this time that the great unknown, so many, not just one, everything, so many unknowns loom before us, let us dare to be all the more vigilant, to hold before us a vision of a world that can be transformed, and to dare to transform ourselves to make it so. With gratitude for all of you who have joined us this morning and folks on Facebook, we say hi. Thanks for coming in. It is a great joy to be together in whatever way that we can find to lift up our voices, to lift up our hearts in song, in worship, in prayer, in thought, in this beloved community that we cherish. Until we meet again, shine on. We're going to go out into this chat room now and see one another and say hello. And then in just a couple of minutes, we'll go into breakout rooms with smaller groups so that we can get to know one another better. So everybody grab your coffee, settle in. We're going to have the next part of our time together, the time that we love so much, where we just flow. Be blessed. Amen. Amen. Aho. Ashe. Namaste. Blessed be. And so it is.